Hello, all subscribed members. Have you ever considered the sequential changes in the deformity of the humerus head in glenohumeral joint osteoarthritis? Do you have any special treatment tools to relieve intractable painful osteoarthritis? Most doctors are familiar with the radiographic findings of glenohumeral joint osteoarthritis, such as joint space narrowing, marginal spur formation, sclerosis, and deformity of the humerus head. However, there is more to understand about glenohumeral joint osteoarthritis. I did not think deeply about the sequential phenomena of osteoarthritis until I evaluated it with detailed pathological findings, mechanisms, and processes before the introduction of MRI. So, I will share my understanding and thoughts on osteoarthritis and more effective treatments for intractable painful osteoarthritis. The deformity of the humeral head in osteoarthritis begins with the wear and tear of the cartilage surfaces of the glenoid and humeral head, leading to thinning and eventual loss of cartilage, which exposes the underlying subchondral bone to increased mechanical stress, resulting in sclerosis and abnormal osteoclast activity. This increased osteoclast activity causes osteolysis and the formation of cysts, visible on MRI as subchondral bone marrow lesions, which weaken the bone matrix and contribute to the depression of the normal convex shape of the humeral head, causing flattening or a biconcave deformity. The changes in bone and cartilage structure alter the distribution of mechanical forces across the joint, leading to abnormal wear patterns and the formation of osteophytes at the joint margins, which further contribute to joint deformity. Please look for the bone marrow signal change in the inferior medial corner of the humerus head and the ongoing process of osteophyte formation. This patient shows subchondral bone marrow changes in the articular process of the scapular bone. The subchondral bone marrow change does not occur only in the inferior medial corner of the humerus head but also in the articular surface or greater tubercle. With the progression of the subchondral bone marrow lesion and stress, the humerus head deforms in shape. Pain in the early and mid stages of osteoarthritis differs from the advanced stage. These stages include the ongoing process of synovial inflammation, the early stage of subchondral bone marrow lesions, and the ongoing process of fibrosing capsulitis. What is the main mechanism of chronic pain in advanced osteoarthritis? According to the natural law, the progression of deformity to increase joint surface area and protective marginal spur formation mostly stabilize the joint and reduce pain. But it sacrifices the range of motion and reduces mobility. However, chronic pain may persist in patients with severely limiting the shoulder's range of motion. We need a basic range of motion to perform daily activities, even during sleep. Although it might not be necessary to mobilize during sleep, most people cannot sleep in a steady, immobile, supine position. They must twist and turn, bearing compressive forces and allowing motion during sleep. So, the limited range of motion is the first pain generator of advanced osteoarthritis. The second pathology of intractable severe osteoarthritis is the ongoing process of subchondral bone marrow pathology and joint inflammation. I shared my perspective on interventional strategies at a previous lecture in the glenohumeral osteoarthritis series. If you did not watch the video, please revisit and study it. Another opportunity to learn the entire picture of interventional pain medicine is through the fellowship course run by Korea University, which I supervise. If you are interested in the course, please log into paindiploma.org or contact the address in the underlying commentary. Let me discuss my patient. These simple x-rays show her left shoulder, and she exhibited severe joint limitation and pain. During the ultrasound examination, I wanted to check the condition of the rotator cuff. However, I could barely observe the supraspinatus tendon because she could not move the supraspinatus and subscapularis tendons. Nevertheless, these tendons are still present, as many severe osteoarthritic patients show preserved rotator cuff tendons. Here, I am trying to observe the subscapularis tendon, but the severe limitation of external rotation hides it due to the close approximation of the lesser tubercle and coracoid process. The same applies to the longitudinal scanning for the subscapularis tendon, where I barely observe the preservation of the subscapularis tendon. Next, I move to observe the supraspinatus tendon in the longitudinal scan, but the close approximation of the greater tubercle and acromion hides the ultrasound window. The left side is the humerus, and the right bony cortical echo is the acromion. I rarely observe the preservation of the supraspinatus tendon. The infraspinatus tendon and posterior joint are easy to observe because there is no covering bony structure. I found an osteophyte at the posterior margin of the scapular articular process or ossification of the posterior glenoid. These findings are common ultrasound features of advanced glenohumeral osteoarthritis. A simple X-ray is sufficient for diagnosing glenohumeral osteoarthritis, but I use ultrasound to detect the amount of joint fluid or subacromial effusion and to assess the intactness of the rotator cuff. When the rotator cuff is torn completely, I opt for an easy intra-articular injection. However, I choose a different injection strategy for cases like this patient. Please follow me for the procedure. Next, let's watch the ultrasound-guided process in my operating room. I used to perform intra-articular steroid injections for all osteoarthritic patients. However, after adopting MRI and developing a different viewpoint, I altered my injection strategy. I now approach a different target, not the joint itself. This approach is a modified version of the adhesive capsulitis injection protocol. I also detailed this technique in a previous lecture. Let me scan it first. I am watching the transverse scan at the upper border of the coracoid process. I found a round cortical echo of the coracoid process on the left-hand side deep to the deltoid muscle. I found an unusual echogenic structure similar to the coracoid process, but it is in the deep superior aspect of the coracoid process. It is an ossified structure in the coracohumeral ligament, separated from the rotator cuff or humerus head. Please watch carefully for the unusual bony structure in the deep upper aspect of the coracoid process. Naturally, my first target will be positioned above the coracohumeral ligament target. So, my needle will be at 12 o'clock position of the scapular glenoid. I administered a drug comprising local anesthetics, steroids, and a Botox mixture. Next, I will switch the target to the inferior capsular injection. She cannot rotate externally, but I will try to rotate her arm as much as she can tolerate. Then, after half flexing her elbow, I will pose my body between her forearm and body. I want to use my dominant hand to hold the needle, which is the most comfortable position for the procedure. The right side is the acromial tip, and the left-hand side is the humerus on the ultrasound image. I follow the cortical echo of the humerus shaft. I slide the probe more medially and find a prominent osteophyte, which is a downward projecting osteophyte from the anatomical neck. The capsule is located peripheral to the osteophyte because the osteophyte is formed at the joint margin, and the capsule is attached to the anatomical neck. So, my needle target will be inferior to the osteophyte and into the inferior capsule. Thank you for watching. As esteemed members, your support greatly motivates my continued journey of practical pain management on YouTube. I look forward to seeing you in the upcoming videos.